The Paradise Incredible, the famous YouTube channel, is devoted to different aspects of our life. The livelihood, different professions, different cultures, and art and living are mostly focused on it. Already we have many episodes already for you. Now we'll go into another very important aspect, very uncommon, exclusive aspect of fine art and culture. There are different varieties of people, different castes, cultures, customs. They are prevalent in India. The Buddhist art or the Himalayan art is very, very exclusively cultural art. And now we will introduce you one very important lady who is nurturing this art exclusively for us. She is not only famous in Darjeeling area, but qualities in contemporary art and culture, as well as the Buddhist or the so-called Himalayan art and culture. She has been awarded in several occasions by the government cultural centers. She had been awarded in 2019 for her exclusive works. She performed different exhibitions throughout India, and she has been glorified and proud enough to show us her activities in arts. Now we'll introduce you that very specific exclusive lady who is with us. Good morning.
Good morning, sir.
I'm happy to see you,
sir,
in your house.
Likewise.
I know that you are already famous. You require no introduction. But even then, for the people at large, for the people worldwide, I like to introduce you to them through our channel, Paradise Incredible. May I know what's your good name, please?
Thank you very much, sir. My name is Tashi Doma Shering, and would you like me to elaborate, sir?
Of course.
Okay. I don't know about being famous, but I am a Thangka artist, a trained Thangka artist from the Mindri tradition. And prior to this, I was an ex-banker. And then I, off since, I've really been focusing on art. I've won many competitions. I've also won an international competition called the Burjuman Drawing and Painting Competition in Dubai, which was held in Dubai, UAE. And of recent, I've also won a state award, state winner for 2019, a two-time district winner from Darjeeling itself. And that's about it.
What actually do really?
I am an artist.
Right.
Yes, focusing on art. And of recent, I've also tied up with DIC, just trying to bring about an awareness, knowledge about our art and tradition, which of course has been passed down from our ancestors. And this is something that I feel that needs to be passed down towards to our future generation. Otherwise, we have such vibrant and rich and art form which has evolved over many, many centuries. But of recent, there has been a lack of interest among the, especially among the younger generation. And the origin of Thangka art is from India, I would like to think. And of course, it's a fact also. And I would like this Thangka art or Buddhist art to be part of our mainstream Indian art. This is my hope, and I really hope that in future it does, you know, come into this this stage where Thangka art is, you know, will become part of our mainstream Indian art.
Actually, what is Thangka art?
Okay, Thangka art is, you could call it actually a Himalayan art or Himalayan Buddhist art. It is in fact 100% correct to call it Himalayan Buddhist art. But it is an artwork that has, you know, endemic to regions of Tibet, Bhutan, Sikkim and the northern parts of India, like
along the Himalayan range.
Yes, along the Himalayan ranges. And Thangka art is of course inextricably linked with Vajrayana Buddhism, and of course Vajrayana Buddhism, the origin is Tibet. So for a practitioner of Thangka, Vajrayana practitioner, Thangka art is a very powerful tool as a meditational tool and as for religious purposes. And it is also a very rigid art form, you know.
Very religious one.
And of course, 100% religious. And you cannot, you have very strict rules and regulations of what to do and what not to do. The iconometrics is very important. A lot of geometry is involved in this, and you really have to be trained to do.
How did you get your training, please?
About 8 years back, 8 to 10 years back, I got trained from this renowned Thangka writer from this, he was basically a monk, and his name is Nima Chiring, from this Rongbul monastery. So that is where I basically got trained in Thangka art.
How long it took to
of
have
course,
your lesson?
Many hours. I wouldn't like to say a particular year, because it's a continuous process. You know, art is something that where you do not learn within a year or within 2 years and then you get a degree. No, it's something that you have to
culture it.
Yes, yes, and you have to hone your skills.
Not a theoretical one.
Yes, but then you have to spend many, many hours, and I'd like to think that I spent many, many hours and many, many, you know, sketches and, you know, trying to refine and hone my, you know, the circles and the smooth flow of lines and all. Those are very important aspects of Thangka art. You know,
the mathematical one, 2 cents.
Yes, that is definitely there, and you know, the lines, especially the lines, and you know, the hands, the legs, and the eyes, they are very, very important. So it has to be almost near perfect. So otherwise, you could see a small, you know, fault in it immediately.
Mm-hmm. In your family, anybody else is culturing this?
Yes, actually my father, who passed away very recently, he wasn't a trained Thangka writer, but he was absolutely fantastic, and I would like to think that, you know, it's in our genes actually.
Right. He encouraged you.
Yes, he encouraged
and influenced
me
you.
And influenced me a lot. And it seems our great-great-grandfather was, in fact, responsible for creating this almost a masterpiece called the Santa Ferry, which is also the depiction, Buddhist depiction of the cosmology, which is there in Peling. If I don't know if you have been there.
I have been there, yeah.
You've been there,
yeah,
in
yeah.
the monastery,
Peling yeah, right,
monastery?
Right.
Yes.
And so,
yes, there is a sculpture, mm-hmm. which is the seven stages of heaven, actually they call it, to paradise. But the original, of course, it's not for public viewing anymore. That, I believe, has been crafted by a great-great-great-grandfather, Lingke Rinpoche. His home is Lingke Rinpoche. So we are direct descendants of this Rinpoche. And I guess so that is why it's in our genes.
Right, that's good.
That's.
But you have been inheriting it.
Yes.
So generations to maybe the next generation also carry on.
Yes, yes.
How do you think that it is important for meditation?
For meditation?
Meditation.
Meditation is something where you have to be 100% aware of what you're doing. People think that, no, you have to sit cross-legged and, just sit for 30 minutes chanting some mantras and all. That actually isn't true, Anything that you do with full dedication and awareness, that itself is meditation. So while I'm doing my work, the time factor gets lost, and I wouldn't realize it, but then, it's been 2 hours have just gone by,
You can know.
Yes. So, as a artist and as a writer, that itself is a powerful meditation tool. And once it is completed, we have higher, the Vajrayana Buddhism has got higher
degree of meditation.
Yes. So that then.
So meditation.
Yes. So that is, of course, then that is done in an entirely different setting, and it's very different kind of meditations.
One thing more,
yes.
This art, yes. What you call it, you used to practice contemporary art.
Yes, prior to this I was...
I used to go through that.
Right.
But now, this thanka art, if you kindly show some examples of different goddesses or goddesses which are important in this culture,
we'll
be happy.
Yes. So, there are so many Buddhist deities, and in total I think about 42, I forget the thing, but total 108 powerful
deities are there.
Yes. So out of which we have and there are categorized into 3 categories, basically the serene deities, which basically all these deities like goddesses and Amitabha and things that they form.
What is this goddess, please?
This is Vaitara.
Vaitara.
Yes, she is basically a goddess who protects you from misfortune and for the benefit of all sentient beings.
Right.
That is one of the main defining aspects of Vajrayana deities. We worship them to benefit each and every sentient beings, and thereby, I guess, accumulating merit.
Is there any special time to meditation or worship?
No, there are particular days.
Right.
I think
for a particular deity.
Yes, for a particular deity, and I think it's the. I'm not very sure, but maybe the 8th day or something is the day where you worship the goddesses, like Tara and things like that. Then you have Chichu, which is for only.
Any other Tara is there?
Yes, there are in total supposed to be 21 taras.
21 taras.
Yes, of different colors and of different purposes.
Of course, okay.
Yes. So,
this is
green tara.
Yes, this is green tara.
This is for what purpose, please?
For benefiting all sentient beings.
Right.
And of course, removal of obstacles, granting of wishes.
Yes. Supreme on that.
Yes, yes. Absolutely supreme.
So, that was a special occasion to celebrate.
Yes,
special day, month.
Right.
Special. Any special possible is there?
Like white flowers.
Yeah, right.
White flowers and like curd and we have this rice preparation that you do with butter and things like that. So, those are special offerings
right.
for
any household preparation.
Yes, yes.
You are not specially prepared for that purpose.
No. We don't have things like that. And of course, offerings of fruits and sweets and things like that.
And also, we should worship our day and night.
Yes. Yes.
That is very essential.
Yes, yes, yes. And you have particular mantras and things like that that needs to be chanted in her honor.
So likewise, there are 19 taras.
21 taras.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's fine.
Yes.
So likewise, you have prepared, so 21 taras.
This is 21 taras. And let me show you another, this is another depiction of white tara.
White tara.
Yes, and I'd like to think of these as my practice pieces. You know? These were done.
But very nice, very beautiful.
Decorated
and prepared.
These were done very early on. Mm-hmm. While I was still learning, actually. So.
But very good.
Thank you.
In a very first-hand deal.
Right.
Really, very. Very much exclusive one.
Okay, sir. Thank you. So, I'd like to just point out, in Thakka art, these, eyes, the hand mudras, and the legs, should just be almost perfect.
Marcus.
Yes, a little deviation, and if it is not right, it's supposed to accumulate negative karma. So, you have to be very careful.
Perfection.
Yes.
Important thing.
We try to aim for perfection, of course, no one is.
Yes. As not perfect is to be.
Yes, absolutely.
You have prepared that.
Yeah, right.
So. Thank you very much. Yeah. Any other art?
Yes, and this is also another, form of depiction of white tara.
Gotcha.
I mean, I did this for the normally thangas you will not find so many floras and faunas,
right.
Because like I said, Himalayan art, there was not much of flora and fauna, so most of the thangas you would only find bare mountains and things like that. Typical of what the landscape in Tibet would look like, and even the lotuses that they have is not like what a real lotus would look like. It was through imagination, I guess, that they made a lotus that looked like this.
Actually, what the lotus signifies?
Lotus signifies purity. Because a lotus is always found where there is a lot of mud and the muddy water and all that. But lotus always blooms from such water, so it is just like coming out from samsara.
Right.
So the lotus significance is very important in Thangka art. So you have a bud, and then you have a half bloomed lotus, and then a fully bloomed lotus. So these three signifies the stages of the circle of life, I guess. From ignorance to realization to ultimate nirvana. So these are,
maturation.
Yes, everything that is there in a Thangka art has got a religious meaning to it. But this particular one I did because I'd like to think of myself as foremost being a naturalist, and I love nature, I love a lot of floras and fauna. So I thought, okay, let me, why, and whatever is done on a Thangka art is also a kind of offering. So in a way, these are my offerings to the deities, the beautiful trees, beautiful flowers, beautiful leaves.
Also, musical instruments also.
Yes, sir. These are all, these are something that is very important in a Thangka art. No Thangka art is complete if you do not have a set of these offerings. These are supposed to be money, the precious stones. Even in Hinduism we have mani,
right?
So these are mani, these are corals, which are precious, semi-precious stones. These are ivory, thus, these are conch, so these instruments, these fruits, incense, many different, but then you have, no Thangka art is complete if you do not have such kind of offerings.
Very good.
Okay.
Any other thing?
Yes, I do have. Now this was actually this is actually a set, and this is one of the winning pieces from district level, which I won. Yeah,
this one.
Yes, both. Yes. So I mean, why I've done it as a set is because of its the throne, something similar. So it's just a set of two. The taras. Yes, two taras.
Good enough.
And let me also show you this. Now this, why this is something that is a complete thanka, okay? But unlike other thankas where they put this Chinese brocade and all, what I try to do is like integrate it into our Bengali
art
and culture. This is known as matka silk, which
this one?
Yes.
Okay.
And this is from Bengal. This is very indigenous to the Bengali silk. This also. This is matka. Also, yes, matka silk. And
this is very raw silk.
Yes. And I thought, like, why not incorporate something which is of Bengal? And my aim also is that as an artist, I should help our local artists as well from Bengal. So if I'm able to outsource their products and use it as part of my art, it is, the purpose, I guess, becomes even more, the intent.
This is white tara.
This is also white tara, done in different depictions.
Right.
I don't like to stick to a particular kind of landscape or thing, I'd like to just push myself, pushing my boundaries, where I'm given a freedom of going about the type of sceneries and things that I like, So this is my way of interpreting different scenic views of a deity.
Do you sell them anyway?
Yes, like I do sell. But as of now, I'm focusing on creating a collection because I want to do a show.
After that, you'll sell that.
Yes, and after that, then my purpose is to. But recently, I've done a portrait of our Honorable Chief Minister, and that was it was commissioned by the Bhutia Board, So I had done her portrait in a thanka style, and I believe they didn't give
that
it to her.
Is complete? Well.
Yes, it's complete. I could probably show you later on a photo of it. Yes.
Thank you. What are these kits?
Now this is
thanka art.
This is also thanka art. Now, this is Ganesha. He is also one of our semi deities.
A beautiful art.
Yes, this is known as Chokta. In Tibetan. So this is a different depiction of the deity. Yes. And like I said, the offerings. Well, these are supposed to be all semi-precious stones, and we have trees, you have animals, you have flowers. So all these are offerings. And then the elephant with the tusk, that itself is also an offering. So
Lara is also there.
Yes.
Very good. Very nice one.
Okay.
Then what paper it is?
This is handmade canvas. It's
handmade?
Yes, handmade canvas.
It's colorful.
Yes, this is, you can also call it like a gold thanka. You have gold thanka, white thanka, red thanka, and black thanka also. So this is the gold thanka.
Thank you.
You're
welcome,
sir. So these are a sneak peek into my collection. And this is also Ganesha, and you could call this like a white thanka.
White thanka.
Yes.
That is golden one, this is white.
Yes.
White one.
But now you can see the, you know, the thing is entirely, you know, in a different setting. The goldfish are also a form of offering and supposed to be a very auspicious. They are known as Serenia.
Serenia?
Yes, Serenia.
Lotus is there.
Yes, lotuses are there.
Other plants also.
Yes, there. And you have the coral, you have the money, you know, you have the fruits, you have the deers and animals who are very important. They play an important part in Buddhism.
Yes. Very good. Really, you devoted a lot of time for this.
Yes, I mean, unless you devote a lot of time, you cannot.
Artistic too. Yes. Legendary artist, I should say.
No,
really, what is your culture? I have gone through different cultures in different countries of the world.
Okay.
But really, they are very much worthy ones.
And
very detailing of the picture is there.
Yes.
Very much detailing.
I'd also like to show you this is Saraswati.
Saraswati.
But who is also one of our deities, you know,
okay.
Like, so.
Buddhism.
Yes. So you can see this is.
Saraswati.
Yes, a different
the goddess of learning.
Yes. And in Vajrayana Buddhism, she is known as Yangchen Lam.
Yangchen Lam.
Lamo.
Lamo.
Yes, Yangchen.
Oh, very good.
Saraswati. It's the same thing, except maybe we in they will not show a peacock and all that.
Right, right.
I thought like okay.
Adding that.
Yes, definitely.
There is special attraction to this picture.
Yes, not only attraction, it's also a form of offering.
Very good. So, very good idea.
Yes. I mean, this is how I've tried to innovate.
Of course. That is the purpose of the artist.
Absolutely.
That is the purpose of that.
What has happened nowadays is that
make it more attractive, more colorful,
yes,
more worthy.
Feeling,
yes.
But what has happened of recent is, you know, I feel like our art is stagnating, you know, whereby people would, you know, they would want a particular kind of thangka art. It should like almost be like a copy.
Mm-hmm, right.
I don't think that. That
should not be the quality of an artist.
Yes,
of
because thangka art itself evolved.
Yes, the artist should evolve.
Absolutely.
Need not.
Absolutely.
Around art. And
another,
creativity should be there.
Right. This is another question of
Saraswati.
Saraswati with a different background.
Right.
You know.
Very good. This is also handmade paper.
Yes, this is handmade paper. I mean, just to make this, no, not paper, canvas.
This canvas.
Yes.
Yeah.
Just to make the canvas, it takes about 2 weeks, you know, for it to dry because you have to stretch it and then you have to put layers of fine this white coating and then you have to smooth
before
it out.
Before preparation of this image.
Yes, because the canvas should be absolutely smooth, you know.
How long it took to prepare?
On an average, it will take about 25 to a month.
Month.
You know, the bigger pieces would probably take about 40 days, 35 days.
What sort of color you use?
Right now, I'm just using acrylic paints.
Acrylic paints.
Yes, acrylic paints. And maybe watercolor.
Mm-hmm. With acrylic.
Yes.
Very good one. So you are enriching art and culture, really.
Yes, I mean
to a great extent.
That is my.
Along with that,
yes.
You are culturing and nourishing thangka art.
Thangka art.
Very. Thank you very much.
So you're welcome, sir.
So you have also done many temporary.
Contemporary
art.
Yes, article.
But I think you are switching on this now.
Yes, I mean, because now since I'm back in my, you know, hometown.
Right.
I realize that there's such a rich history of art in our culture and even in our religion. And then I also realized, you know, that over a period of time, how, you know, it has almost degraded or stagnated. And
you are revitalizing the culture.
Revitalizing the culture. And I feel if we do not do that, then probably our art will just die out.
Really?
And I would like the future generation to continue with this rich form. And the innovation should take place.
Of course.
Because how art was before and how it is now, you know, Thanka art is like, and people don't want to spend too much time in doing detailed work and all, because obviously, so then the quality of work
degrading also.
Yes,
because they are not devoting their mind in it.
Absolutely, because they just want to do it quickly so that they can just sell it off. And I don't think that's that should be the motive. Or the
purpose. Right. So some contemporary art articles you can go through.
Yes, definitely.
Then that will be worthy also.
Right, sir.
Okay.
I'd like to also just add, sir, that Thanka art is also a part of our cottage industry, because it forms a basis, because cottage industry is basically work which the workers have inherited, like art. They have inherited art as their work from their ancestors. And cottage industry being one of the traditional industries of India, because it has existed from the 15th century onwards, even way before the British East India Company. It accounts for almost about 80% of the employment, manufacturing employment in India. And this is also one of my plea to the government and to the administrative agencies, that I feel that they should, focus on
art. That is, nourish them.
Yes, and to generate employment, I feel, because
not only employment, there are also some selling,
yes,
so that they will be encouraged.
Absolutely.
To do that.
So if an industry is
how to survive, then it should be supported by.
Yes, of course. And I feel like the government can do a lot, you know, to help artisans such as me.
Did you approach the government?
I have, and we have submitted quite a few projects, but it's been,
not really attended with.
Yes, I feel all these things tend to get overlooked. But then these are very important things, because eventually what survives is the art, you know. Art survives a kingdom, it survives, a society, it survives an era, you know. Had it not been for all those great artists of the Mayans, the Egyptians or the Indians, we wouldn't have known how our history was. So,
right.
I feel there's a very big danger of,
the
coming generation, yes, losing out on
it. Is there any possibility that other artists like you,
yes,
those who are culturing Thanka art,
yes,
in India and other places, they join hand with you?
As of now, no. But we did have a workshop which was...
Did you have any association?
We don't have an association.
No, you should form an association.
Yes.
So that we can...
Yes, this has...
You can join hand to fight your motives.
Right.
Your grievances.
Yes, this has been one of my focus. But then due to the lockdown, after 2019...
Now it is becoming normal.
Now it's becoming normal. So these are one of my focuses.
Yeah, right.
Now I'm hoping that things will again.
No, you should nourish it. So
yes, absolutely.
Very ancient art, you say.
Yes, absolutely ancient.
Thousands of years ago,
yes,
it was there, and now you are culturing only this.
Yes.
So government should also come forward, and also the people at large, they should encourage. Yeah.
Yes,
they should have exhibitions also in different places in India and outside.
Right,
as you did earlier.
Right, sir.
And also you have other artists to join you, so that all together you can do very good thing.
Right, sir.
Yeah, people will influence very good art, very artistic. Those who are artistic one, they must appreciate your works, legendary works, I should say.
So, in fact, recently we had a workshop which was done by DIC, and this workshop was attended by Assamese, Manipuri, and there were a few Bengali artists also. And they were established from Chitrakala, I think, academy or something like that. And then there was one interactive discussions we were having, and then they pointed out, you know, because they themselves being artists and art teachers, they pointed out like, how come this is missing, you know, such a sophisticated and
It should take to the public.
Yes.
First thing is that they do not know.
Absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely.
They in the media also, you should propagate that.
Right.
You should write some articles also.
Right.
So that there are many people those you will be interested with.
Absolutely.
But you must take them to them.
Right, sir.
Right. Otherwise, how they can know?
Absolutely.
How they will be interested with?
Absolutely, sir.
So it is your duty, I think.
Right.
Of course, our channel will do that because it is spread throughout the world.
Right. So many thank you so much, sir.
Subscribers are there.
Yes, sir.
But I think you also do that.
Right, sir.
From your side.
Right.
Having your leadership.
Right. Really hoping for something positive.
Positive, yes, yes. Anyway, thank you very, very much.
Sir, most welcome, sir.
In this trust channel, in these people,
sir,
so definitely we'll give it in the website.
Right,
so that throughout the world, people will be encouraged to see through.
Right, sir.
Right.
So, and I mean, especially thanks to people like you, you know.
Right, sir. Right, it's my great pleasure to visit you and engage me with this culture. Making people Indies with your culture.
So thank
you. That is Thonka art, very rare art, very sophisticated, legendary art.
Right,
people all should know.
Right, sir.
Thank you very much.
Sir.
Okay,
thank you
see
so
you
much,
again.
Sir.